Hi, everyone. My name is Pranav Nambiar, and I'm a senior manager of product management on the Database Services Group. First of all, I'd like to welcome all of you to this session on managed database services on AWS. Just as the name suggests, we're going to talk about the various managed database services that we have on AWS. We're going to walk through the various use cases. We're going to talk about what are the advantages of each of these. We're going to look at how they can help you offer more value for your businesses. Also, we have with us Jiang Sang, who is the VP of Engineering from IGA Works. IGA Works is the number one mobile business platform in Korea, and so we'll get to hear a lot of his insights working with many of these managed database options. So before we get started, I actually wanted to, you know, start off with some interesting questions, because I'm sure most of you who have worked with databases have encountered most of these questions before. So let's start with those. It's going to be an interesting, fun exercise. How many of you have encountered situations where you felt that your database was pretty much like a Swiss Army knife? Keeps trying to solve a lot of different problems, but doesn't quite do the best job at all these problems. I can see a lot of hands being raised, a lot of heads being nodded. Well, indeed, it's been a very common problem that we see across the board. How about this one? How many of you have had to deal with situations where you had to manage costs, performance, or speed and scale, you know, and it's been troubling you all through and you're still not sure whether you've nailed it completely? Any show of hands? Oh, again, a bunch, right? Okay, how about this last one? This should be more easy, I believe. How many of you have wished that databases were worry-free zones? Well, that's pretty much an obvious answer, I guess, right? Well, obviously, databases are not that easy to manage. They are complex. So, and of course, I can't promise you that I can get rid of all your worries, but here's what I'll promise you. By the end of this session, you would have enough insights at a high level about the various options that we have at your disposal, which are going to enable you to drive more value in a more efficient way for your businesses. Ultimately, I'm sure it's going to bring down your worries and help you increase more value for your business. With that, let's dive right in. Let's start off by first looking at what are we going to cover in this session. We'll start by looking at what are managed databases, why do we want them. We'll then look at the big two categories, NoSQL versus SQL databases. And then we'll walk through the four key managed database options that we have on AWS, DynamoDB, RDS, Elastic Cache, and Redshift. And then we'll have Jiang Sang, who's going to share with us the insights from IGA Works, and then we'll wrap up. I know we have a lot to cover. I'm going to do my best to make sure you've got high-level insights into all these options so that you know what you need to consider for your business. So it may be difficult for us to have a Q&A session in this session because of the time constraints, but I'll be around even after the session is over, so feel free to reach out. We also have a database booth, so you can always come over there to get your questions clarified. So with that, let's get started with our first and most fundamental question. Why manage databases? To understand why manage databases, we should first understand what does it take to manage a database. Essentially, if you look at it, I'm pretty sure quite many of you have managed databases yourself. So you need to deal with hardware. You need to deal with your maintenance, OS maintenance and installs and patches. You need to deal with your database software, scaling, security, backup, restore, and whatnot. And on top of that, you also need to deal with your app, which is ultimately what you are selling to your customers. What if you could get rid of a chunk of that from your shoulders onto AWS? That's where EC2 comes in. With EC2, AWS will take care of the hardware part, the OS installation part, but you still have to take care of your databases, you have to take care of your patches, your backups, upgrades, security, and in addition to that, you also have to focus on your app. Now, what if you could get rid of the database part also off your shoulders? That's where managed databases come in. So essentially, what managed databases offer you is an ability to automatically take care of your hardware, OS, database software, backups, restore, replication, security, and everything else, so that you can focus on your application. That's where you get best bang for the buck. That's where you can differentiate. That's where you can add maximum value for your customer. The rest AWS can take care of. You can easily tweak it, configure it with just simple clicks or simple calls to APIs, and the rest is automatically managed for you. That's what managed databases offer for you. So to summarize, you have three options. You can go the fully self-managed route where you do everything, heavy loads on your shoulder, but yes, you have a lot of control with that. You can manage the hardware, select the OS that you want, pick the software that you want, pick the changes that you want. Yes, you have a lot of control. The other option is to go the EC2 route, where you can let Amazon handle the OS and the hardware part, but you still manage your database, its processes, and your application. And the final option is, of course, the fully managed route, where you just focus on your application while AWS handles the rest for you. So in this session, we are primarily going to focus on the third option, basically the managed database option that we need. On that note, let's look at what are the various managed database options we have on AWS. So in this session, we're going to look at four database options. The first one is Amazon DynamoDB, which is a NoSQL key value store and document store as well. We have RDS, which is our SQL database solution. We have ElastiCache, which is our in-memory key value store. And then we have Redshift, which is our data warehousing solution. So we're going to look at all of these at a high level so you have insights into which ones to use when, what are the advantages of all of these, et cetera. But as you can see, yes, there are a bunch of options, each specialized in different specific use cases. That's exactly what we are recommending as well. Basically, gone are the days when you say one size fits all. What we want you to do is to pick the right tools for the right task, because that's how you can drive efficiency, and that's how you can get best value for your business. However, yes, when you have a lot of tools, there are always these questions on, hey, which tool should I pick? Which one is better? What should I compromise? Is there a compromise somewhere? What do I do? Right, the many questions that you can ask. You can start with, hey, should I go the NoSQL route or the SQL route? Should I pick Aurora? Should I pick DynamoDB? So we'll look at all of these questions at a high level as we dive deeper into each of these options one by one. Let's start with the most fundamental question that pretty much most of you might have asked at some stage. NoSQL versus SQL. I'm sure most of you are pretty familiar with SQL. You have a very well, strongly defined schema. You can model complex relationships and transactions. There's a lot of focus on data consistency. You also have, some challenges when it comes to performance and availability at really, really high scales. On the other hand, NoSQL goes the simple route. There's no schemas or constraints like that. Works with very simple data types. There's a lot of focus on performance and availability at scale, can work at really, really large scales, and there's lesser focus on consistency. So when you're thinking of your use cases, ideally you need to think through, hey, what exactly are you trying to accomplish? Do you really need complex transactions and relationships? Do you actually need to scale at a very large level or not? What is exactly your user base? How exactly are the patterns that you're actually trying to accomplish? Not just short term, even long term, so you can get an idea of which path to take. It's possible that you might take both. You might have some use cases for your business which uses DynamoDB or your NoSQL solution, some which uses a SQL solution. So as far as AWS is concerned, we're going to look at DynamoDB, which is our NoSQL database, and we're going to look at RDS, which is our SQL database. And we're going to look at different use cases around it. Let's dive right in. Let's start with DynamoDB. So what is DynamoDB? DynamoDB is a fully managed NoSQL database that offers you single-digit millisecond latency at pretty much any scale. Now, to understand this, let me first start off with the use cases in terms of where exactly is DynamoDB applicable. Pretty much everywhere, pretty much every modern use case, you would see DynamoDB having a value there. So we have customers from the ad tech sector who use DynamoDB to record you know, tons and tons of user data, key value store data for real-time bidding and ad retargeting. We've got Internet of Things, you know, companies in that field actually using DynamoDB to record data from millions of devices. We've got gaming companies using DynamoDB for leaderboards, using it for user history and logs. We even have mobile and web companies using DynamoDB for session tracking, personalization information, metadata logging, et cetera. In general, you can see that most of these are very sensitive to performance. They also need really, really large levels of scale and availability. So how does DynamoDB fit into these, or why? What are the main aspects that DynamoDB offers to actually make it suitable for these? So the first one is, of course, consistent performance. So we have customers, you know, hitting DynamoDB with millions of requests, and still they get single-digit millisecond latency at all times. And consistency in performance is super key in today's world, because once you see a smaller service, you know that users are just going to move over to something that's much more faster, right? So the other aspect also worth noting is that DynamoDB automatically replicates your data across three availability zones. So what this means is, when you make a write, your data is written into a master copy, and it's also replicated twice. The call that you make to write, writes it to the master, replicates it to one of the replicas, and then returns, while the other replica is written asynchronously. So now when you make a read, you have two choices. You can say, I need a strongly consistent read, in which case it's going to hit the master node and say, OK, give me the master copy, give me the latest value. Or you can go the eventually consistent route, and you can say, hey, just give me the data from any one of the replicas as fast as possible. So yes, eventual consistency is going to provide you a little bit more faster performance as opposed to strong consistency, but it's an option that you can choose. It's a parameter that you can pass in the API, and it's up to you how you want to utilize it. Now, internally, though, how does DynamoDB operate? So as I mentioned, it's a NoSQL data store, so there's no schema as such. So at a simplest level, it consists of tables. Tables consist of rows that we call items, and items consist of different columns or attributes. Since it doesn't have a schema, you know, your columns, your attributes don't have to be the same. They don't have to be the same in number. The only thing that you need is you need a unique value, which we call the hash ID or the item key, to actually identify that item. That's as simple as that. You could have JSON documents to store there. You can have multiple attributes in the items to store there. Now, I'm sure you might be wondering, hey, oh, that sounds good, but how exactly do you provision it? How many nodes do you pick? Which nodes should you pick? What configuration should you take? Well, you don't have to do anything of that sort. It's as simple as turning a knob. So with DynamoDB, what you actually do is you pick a table and you say, hey, I need 1,000 writes per second and maybe 2,000 reads per second from this database. Specify your throughput that you need, and then DynamoDB will take care of the necessary provisioning. It'll figure out how to partition your table across the board, how many nodes you would need, how many resources you would need. All that is going to be taken care of for you without you having to bother at all. So the biggest advantage is, you know, as customers, you know, hey, this is the level of service that I actually want to give to my customers. I think I'll have so many users. I think this is the speed at which I need it. I think so many users would I'd be getting in the mornings. So many requests is what I'll be getting in the evenings. You have a sense of that. It's much easier for you to, you know, tell us, hey, this is the service level that I need, and we can determine the resources for you underneath. So what it means is, also, in terms of pricing, essentially, you have the flexibility to increase your throughput, or you can decrease it based on your traffic. So it's possible many customers, you know, increase their throughput requirements during the daytime when they have high traffic, and later during the evenings, they just pull it down. In the end, you just pay for what you provision or use. So you pay for the storage that you consume and the level of throughput that you use. So you can always increase it or decrease it, and you just pay for the amount that you've actually utilized. So thanks to all these functionalities, ability to scale, provide you consistent latency, DynamoDB has been really popular with most of these modern use cases. We've seen a lot of customers actually use DynamoDB. IGA Works is an example, and you'll hear from Jiang Shang soon. We have got companies like AdRoll on, you know, from AdTech. We've got Electronic Arts from on the gaming side. Tokyo Hands is another company which is on the IoT side. You know, we have even MLB. You might have heard from the keynote as well. They also use DynamoDB internally. We've got Redfin, which stores billions of records on DynamoDB. A bunch of customers from different sectors, all of them focused on scale and consistent performance. So I hope that gives you a high-level overview of DynamoDB. Let me, you know, move on to the next big item, RDS. So what exactly is RDS? So RDS is our relational database service that offers you fully managed, fast, predictable performance across a bunch of different SQL engines. So the key SQL engines that we support are MySQL, PostgreSQL, SQL Server, and Oracle. And of course, in the keynote, you might have heard of MariaDB. And we also have our own homegrown SQL engine, Aurora. And I'm going to spend some time talking about Aurora. As you might have heard, it's now the fastest growing SQL database engine on AWS. So before I dive deeper into RDS, let's again look at where exactly RDS may be applicable to you, right? So pretty much everywhere where you need SQL, you could use RDS. You could use it for your e-commerce websites, for your mobile apps, for your games, for your analytics reports, for your IT solutions. Wherever you need SQL, you pretty much can use RDS, and it's going to give you a fully managed experience. Now, on that note, you know, I mentioned about the various SQL engines that RDS supports. So at a simple level, RDS pretty much supports all the key functionalities that you'd need across the various SQL engines. You have VPC, you have high availability, you have encryption at rest, you have replication, cross-region support, you have provisioned IOPS. You've got pretty much all those functionalities across the various databases. I'm sure you're pretty much familiar with the ones on the right, MySQL, PostgreSQL, Oracle, and SQL Server. I just want to spend some time on Aurora specifically, because that's going to be something insightful for you all. So before we started on the track of, you know, building Aurora, we asked ourselves one simple question. If we were to redesign relational databases, what exactly would we do? We only placed one condition that we had to meet as a result of that. And that condition was, no matter what we build, it has to be a relational database. So the end result was Aurora. Aurora uses a distributed storage layer, and hence it's able to scale much more better than the other databases. It automatically scales the storage. Your data is replicated 6 times across 3 different availability zones. It can scale up to 64 terabytes of data, and it can support up to 15 replicas, and it's 5 times more faster than MySQL. So Aurora is fully compatible with MySQL, and so if you're considering a MySQL database, it might be worthwhile evaluating Aurora as an option because it's much more faster and easier for you guys to utilize. On that note, you know, let's look at RDS in general in terms of what are the key functionalities that it offers you to make your life simpler. So talking about simplicity, the first and key, you know, most important thing is RDS makes it really easy for you to set up and scale. It's a matter of you picking what kind of nodes that you need. You can actually pick a, you know, CPU intensive one. You can actually pick ones that are, you know, optimized for burst. You can pick the kind of, you know, instance that you want. You also have the flexibility to change the instance later on, modify it. Of course, you need to be, you know, aware of some availability time that needs to be done, you know, accommodated for during that interval. You also have the option of, you know, increasing your storage, and for that, you don't even have to, you know, bring down your instance, or there won't be any availability concerns around that. Talking about storage, RDS supports 3 kinds of storage. First one is a general purpose SSD, which pretty much supports almost all your, you know, typical scenarios where you need moderate level of IOPS. The other one is the provisioned IOPS. So what provisioned IOPS does is it provides you a guaranteed performance. You can specify the level of input-output operations that you need from that from RDS, and it's going to try to meet it with provisioned IOPS. This is specifically useful for high-performance OLTP use cases, you know, where performance matters a lot, and so you need consistent performance. You can use that. And the third option is, of course, the magnetic store, which is mainly meant for smaller, you know, use cases where you're not using it frequently. It's much more cheaper, of course, and performance is not that big a concern for you. Another aspect worth noting is the multi-AZ support that RDS offers. So essentially, with just a click of a button, you can deploy RDS across multiple AZs. And RDS would synchronously replicate your data across them. So if one of the AZs fails, RDS would automatically fail over to the other, that way guaranteeing you high availability. You can also go cross-region. So you can have a master database in one of the regions, and you can create read replicas in other regions. So if you have a really global application or a global system where you need locally available data for reads, you can actually drive more performance by actually having the data in a local region, because that's going to reduce your latency. You also, of course, have disaster recovery thanks to this, because you have a lot of different replicas around. You also have the flexibility to promote some of these replicas into masters and utilize them separately. Coming to the final part, which is the pricing, I'm sure you'll be thinking, okay, so how much does it cost? Well, basically, you again just pay for what you use. You pick the nodes that you want, the duration for which you utilize, you just pay for that, and the storage. It's as simple as that. You always have the option of changing it. You can select what kind of storage that you need or what kind of instances that you need to provision, and that's it. You have the flexibility to change. You don't have to bother about the hardware, the OS, the database, et cetera. It's pretty much done for you. You can pick what you want and adjust as you move. Now, given RDS, making life so easy, we have seen a lot of customers move to RDS. A good example is Samsung. So Samsung moved to RDS, and they managed to save 85% in their OPEX expense after coming to RDS. We've got other companies like Flipboard, who support millions of users and billions of page flips for the Flipboard app. That's also driven via RDS. So I'm assuming that gives you a high-level overview of RDS. Let's dive deeper into the next big one, Elastic Cache. What exactly is Elastic Cache? Just like its name suggests, it's an in-memory key-value store that supports high-performance storage of data, which is fully managed with two key caching engines, Memcached and Redis. We'll talk about it in a sec. But before we dive deeper, let's again take a step back and look at, hey, where exactly would Elastic Cache be applicable? First and foremost, it's applicable as a caching layer between your application and database. We see a lot of customers using that and benefiting from reduced latencies as a result of that. We also see customers using it for temporary key value store. We also see customers using it for certain complicated scenarios, specific scenarios like event counters in memory or in-memory lists or leaderboards. So these are specific things where you can have certain data types like Redis supports, which is going to enable you make this, accomplish this much more easily. Talking about Redis and Memcached, so essentially these are two really common caching engines that are out there. Memcached is the more simpler one, simple key-value pair. So with Elastic Cache, you can always add a node, and Elastic Cache automatically will detect the node and add it and recognize it. It also allows you to place your nodes across different availability zones. Redis offers much more functionalities compared to Memcached. It allows you data types like sets and in-memory lists. It also provides you for persistence. It enables you to set up read replicas. Also, Elastic Cache enables you to deploy it across availability zones and automatically fail over from one availability zone to the other. But in general, though, when you talk about Elastic Cache, it is again nothing but a set of instances that you can set up based on your requirement, based on the amount of memory that you need as your caching layer or in-memory key-value store. When it comes to cost, it's pretty much the same. You just pay for the number of nodes and the duration for which you use the nodes. You always have the option and the flexibility to scale up or down. It's as simple as a couple of API calls or a couple of clicks on the console, and that's it. You can easily control it the way you want. Again, because it's a popular use case, caching, yes, we have a lot of companies trying to use Elastic Cache. A good example is we have Expedia, which uses around a 400-node cluster of Elastic Cache. DealFlix is another great example. They use Elastic Cache as a caching layer and manage to reduce their latency by over 80%. So again, this is something that can be pretty useful for you. If latency is a concern, it serves as a good caching layer for you. You can use it for in-memory store of specific data types as well. Now, with that, I hope you get a high-level overview of Elastic Cache. Let me quickly move on to the other big one, Redshift. So what is Redshift? Redshift is Amazon's massively parallel petabyte scale data warehousing solution, which is a lot faster, a lot cheaper, and a lot simpler than most of the solutions that you can find in the market. For as less as $1,000 per terabyte a year, you can actually have Redshift set up. You can get started with as less as 25 cents an hour. It's a pretty fast-paced, fast-growing solution, and we're seeing a lot of customers onboarding to it. On that note, maybe let's take a look at what are the use cases, what kind of customers are actually looking at Redshift. So we're seeing a lot of traditional enterprises moving their data warehouses from on-prem to actually Redshift, and that's because Redshift offers it more than 10 times cheaper pricing for all this. You don't need to have your separate crew to maintain your data warehouses. Redshift does everything for you at much, much more easier level. You also have companies with big data, ad tech companies, gaming companies, also moving to Redshift. Primarily, it provides you a lot more faster speed in your analytics. It also is much simpler. It works with a lot of BI tools, and so it's very compatible with other options, and so people really like it that way. We also see a lot of software as a service companies coming over to Redshift, who offer analytics as another service along with their typical software services. And again, the biggest thing that appeals to them is that you can always grow, you can scale as you grow. So, as your business grows, you always have the option of, adding more or reducing your nodes to actually grow appropriately. But to understand Redshift, properly, we just need to look at a high-level architecture of what constitutes Redshift. So basically, you have a leader node, which is responsible to be your SQL endpoint. It is also going to coordinate your query execution across a bunch of compute nodes. So it's a massively parallel system, and so you can have a lot many compute nodes who are all going to do your query execution in parallel. They're also going to do your data loading in parallel from various data sources like DynamoDB, S3, EMR, and so on. The two data storage options, you have a hard disk option and you have a SSD option. Again, you can pick the one that you want depending on the performance and the cost factors that you feel are more applicable to your businesses. Now, the big part of Redshift compared to all the other systems is its speed. What makes it faster? Why is it that other systems are not that fast? The biggest thing is it's architected that way so that there's a lot more optimization for speed. First of all, Redshift has a columnar data store. So essentially, when you make queries around columns, since it's stored in a columnar fashion, it's much more faster. Also, aggregation, for example, here if you want to aggregate on the amount column, because it's stored together, it's easier to aggregate. You don't have to read through the whole row one after the other. Also, Redshift offers data compression. So since it's stored as a column, the like data types in the same column, so it can easily compress it. It also utilizes zone maps where you can have a min and max value for the various blocks to identify which blocks are applicable for your query and skip over the others. It also supports large data blocks and direct attached storage. So the block size that Redshift uses is around 1 MB, and comparatively, the traditional systems use around 2 KB to 32 KB block sizes. So with such a big size, you reduce the total number of I/O requests that you need, and that way you get a lot more performance. Another part to note is that it supports full continuous and incremental backups. So your data is not just replicated within the cluster. It also can be backed up to S3 incrementally. You can also back it up across regions. And so if there is any disaster in one region, you always have the option to come back. So talking about disaster and failures, so there are, Redshift is built to be fault tolerant. So if a disk fails, it's going to immediately pull up a separate copy of that disk, which is in the cluster, and it's going to bring up a new disk in the place of the older disk in the meantime. If a whole node fails, it's going to bring up a new node. And the data is not lost. You have other replicas in the same cluster, so you can continue operating. If there's a network failure, or even if there's an AZ level failure, you can set up your backups, such that you can actually, revert back to a cross-region replica of the data in S3. You always have the option to handle it, however you want in terms of if there is any failure in any place. That level of flexibility is provided to you by Redshift. Coming to the pricing part, again, it's the same story. You pay for what you use. You pick the instances that you want. Your leader node is free. You only pay for the compute nodes that you have. And then you can always change it, increase, decrease it based on your load. And as I mentioned, you know, for you can actually have 1 terabyte per year for just $1,000, which is pretty much around, you know, 10 times more cheaper than many other solutions that you have in the market. In terms of an ecosystem, so Redshift has supports pretty much most of your business intelligence tools, whether it's Tableau or TIBCO or Qlik. There are also different partners. AWS has a huge partner network, and it's a growing partner network to actually help with the data integration into Redshift, also to build solutions on Redshift. You know, there are a lot of partners, system integrators like Accenture, et cetera. And finally, you know, a lot of customers actually are moving on to Redshift. As you can see, big enterprises, we even have NASDAQ, we even have Nokia who moved to Redshift and managed to save 50% in costs. So overall, a lot of different customers moving on to Redshift, trying to, seeing the value in Redshift. And definitely, it's something, if you're considering as a data warehousing solution, it's going to be a big value add for you all. So with that, I'm going to, hand over the stage to Jiang Sang. So he's going to walk you through some of his insights from IGAWorks. It might be really interesting to see, how these actual database options make a difference to an actual customer's business. And Jiang Sang is going to give you more details on that. Over to you, Jiang Sang.
Hello, everyone. I'm from Korea, not North Korea, so please calm down. Yeah, and understand my diction and something else. Anyway, I'm very honored to be here and share some of the challenges that I faced and how I redesigned the architecture to improve IGAWorks business solutions. Before I get started, let me show you a video introducing IGAWorks.
It is not easy to be a successful application in this overflowing mobile business. Developers don't even have enough time to only think about the contents in order to make it better, while more and more problems are piling up as its launch is getting around the corner. Therefore, IGAWorks provides various functions for publishing application to help a developer only focus on thinking about better contents. Analytics. Analyzing index is as important as making a good application. You can make a right decision at a right timing by analyzing index. Marketing. IGAWorks provides the most essential marketing methodology and solution across the lifecycle of applications, and continuously pioneering new marketing plan for the success of developer. Live operation. We guarantee no pain in developer's neck by providing strong operation functions without developer's help. Marketers deliver push messages and important notices to target users through the thorough analysis and have no problem in cross-promoting and issuing the event coupons. Monetization. Please don't miss the guaranteed monetization possibilities. IGAWorks provides various solutions to maximize your monetization, especially our mediation function, allowing many of global advertisements in one screen, makes your media operation way easier. IGAWorks has always contemplated what kind of service is needed to developers. When you feel that you need something, that something becomes our next project. Now, focus on making better contents without worrying others. All functions are provided for free. What you imagine turns into reality with IGAWorks. IGAWorks.
Yeah, as you can see, IGAWorks provides various solutions for mobile app business. First, AdBricks. AdBricks is the best app analytics and marketing attribution platform in Korea. Over 9,000 applications, especially 70% of top-grossing apps in Korea, are using AdBricks to get analyzed indexes and check marketing performance. AdPopCon is the most biggest monetization platform in Korea, so app developers can maximize their monetization with AdPopCon. Live operation provides marketers to deliver push messages and in-app pop-up to the right person at the right time. Nanu and Jiber is in-app engagement solution, so app developers can easily integrate in-app chatting solution and in-app community features. And all these services are provided for free, so feel free to try IGL services. In 2011, IGL Works moved all services to AWS. With AWS, we quickly developed our the most valuable points of at PopCon and released in 2012. Looking at the architecture, our architecture was so simple. We used Route 53 as DNS, and we implemented two backend services, one for analytics and one for tracking API. And our tech stack was also simple. We just built this using C#, ASP.NET MVC, IIS, and MySQL. But while our service was growing bigger, we weren't able to handle all of the activities with this small size of infrastructure. And moreover, sometimes we dealt with a massive and unpredictable inflows of traffic. For example, if Clash of Clans is the very famous game, get to integrate our service, then we would get unpredictable heavy traffic. So we had to scale out over hundreds of EC2 instances and dozens of MS SQL instances. And finally, we handle 1 billion requests per day, and we used over 1 petabyte of EBS volumes to store process device activities. Here's the challenges I faced. First, cost burden. IGA Works provide all services for free, so we had to optimize the infra cost. Second, operational burden. We had a small team that only has 12 members, so we didn't want to spend our human resources to manage infrastructure. So we decided to use AWS managed services as much as possible. And third, performance improvement. As I mentioned, sometimes we dealt with unpredictable massive traffic, so our new architecture should provide our rapid growth. And it requires high performance. Due to these challenges, we decided to change architectures of at PopCon. At PopCon is most effective monetization platform. So any application can be a media for incentive budget ads. Incentive budget ads means that an application which rewards a user in exchange for completing an action such as the download an application and some watch a video, log in social media, and so on. To understand it easily, I had to explain the sequence of the participating incentive budget ads. Let me assume that a user wants to participate in incentive budget ads using OfferWall. Then a user will open it. After that, OfferWall requests available ads to SERP API. And then SERP API reads available ads from an inventory database, and then check participation logs and deliver available offers to user. And then user will take an offer and install and run this application. And then advertiser's application send the first run activity to SERP API. Most important point is that advertiser doesn't want to spend their money for twice, so monetization platform should deduplicate spending budget. So to do this, SERP API store this first run activity as a participation log and give the promised reward to user. So we got 2 points to improve performance at inventory and participation log. An advertisement campaign has the complex relational data. For example, an advertisement campaign can have multiple ad groups A multiple ad group can have multiple ads, and multiple ads can have multiple creatives, and each creative can be evaluate performance and can be modified. So it should be stored in relational database. And this ad inventory requires millions of read requests every day. So we need a solution to boost that read performance of relational database. And as I mentioned, a participation log is very important to monetization platform. When a user get reward, then the SRF API write this log while SRF API is getting it. So it requires high read and write throughput and low latency to serve it fast. Due to points of improved performance, we changed architectures and technologies of at PopCon. First, we applied RDS and Elastic Cache for managed ad inventory, and we also applied the DynamoDB for participation log. After changing this, we guaranteed 2-digit millisecond latency to serve as advertisement. And to provide real-time monetization report, we used Kinesis and Elastic Beanstalk Worker and RDS Monetization DB. We could provide a good real-time report to our both of advertiser and media. Next use case is AdBricks. Our legacy architecture stored all the activities to MySQL instances. It means that all the data is stored to EBS volumes. EBS volumes is quite expensive to store raw data, and the relational database is hard to scale out and distribute the user data. And moreover, one of instances has trouble, then our whole service should be failed because we didn't have auto failover system. And the size of the storage limitation make us frustrated. DBA should constantly monitor the storage, whether it is full or not every day. So we decided to change this legacy architecture to big data platform. And finally, we applied the EMR Spark for daily batch analysis. And we tried to use Amazon Lambda and Redshift for microbatch analysis. Here's our final architecture. So activity tracker get device activities, then it send it to Kinesis log stream. And activity process will process that device activities and store it to S3. After data is stored to S3, then AdBricks does daily batch analysis and microbatch analysis. Daily batch analysis makes daily indexes such as DAU, retention, cohort analysis, funnel analysis, and so on. After finishing daily batch analysis, all the analyzed index is stored to AdBricks database, and marketers can access these analyzed indexes with AdBricks web application. Microbatch analysis makes hourly indexes such as hourly purchase report and retail user analysis and so on. Microbatch analysis required for marketers in e-commerce industry because they sell product, not an application. An advertising campaign to selling products is sensitive to time because they change their creative many times when their performance is going down. An interesting point is that we are using cross-region replication between Tokyo region and North Virginia because a running cost of Redshift in North Virginia is cheaper than Tokyo region. So we reduced 15% of running cost of Redshift. So I would like to thank the DB heroes. For RDS, if we use the self-managed relational database, then the HA and DR configuration could be a big hurdle. But by using RDS, we saved our operation cost. And DynamoDB was our true hero. It guarantees a one-digit latency, so we could guarantee a two-digit millisecond latency. And using Elastic Cache, we could boost the read performance of RDS. And we are using both Memcached and Redis. And Redshift is really super fast big data warehouse. It is compatible with S3, so we could export the report using S3 anytime. For example, we assume it takes like several hours to analyze huge data from 100 million devices in Redshift, but it took just only 10 seconds, so we was very impressed. And here's a monthly cost report of IJWorks. From new architecture, we reduced 40% of monthly cost. But you might be curious why the total cost is growing up, because IJWorks is making the next step with new application at the same time. But you can see all of the AWS managed services are newly added. So we are trying to fully utilize that AWS managed database. Here's the result. So as I said, we reduced 40% cost of analysis, and we are trying to save it up to 60%. And second, our new architecture scaled out more easily to support 130 million devices. And last, our SR API guaranteed two-digit millisecond latency, so we could survive in this latest latency-sensitive ad tech market. And another important point is that IJWorks changed recruitment policy. We are looking for passionate and endurable developers and let them learn AWS services. So AWS has responsibilities to complex backend technologies, and our developers implement business logics based on it. That's the strategy of IJWorks, providing better solutions. And yeah, here's my last slide. IJWorks started with small business and team, but we tried to release our services as fast as we could. And AWS helped us so much things to do it. And I want to say, start your business today. Sometimes you got trouble, but AWS already has the solutions. With AWS, you're going to be the great solution. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Jiangsang. So, pretty insightful to see actually how, you know, databases in operation when you see, you know, with customers, how exactly it makes a big difference. Pretty insightful to also see how IJWorks has actually utilized different databases in different use cases. You saw it with Redshift. You saw how they use DynamoDB, Elastic Cache for their latency requirements. Then they use Redshift, RDS for their SQL scenarios. So, it's worthwhile, you know, to evaluate these options as you consider various things for your businesses as well. So to sum it all up, I just wanted to go back to the three questions that I started off with. You know, the first one was the Swiss Army knife model, where we had this one-size-fits-all, you know, situation. And as you have seen, you know, with all these different database options, the ideal way for you to move on further with more, you know, value for your customers is to actually pick the right set of tools for the right set of problems, and that will help you not only reduce costs, it's also going to help you improve performance and add more value to your customers. We looked at the three big problems, you know, in terms of performance, scale, cost for databases, which is a pretty common set of problems. And, you know, even IJWorks had the same set of problems as Jiangsang mentioned. And again, by picking the right set of tools and architecting it the right way, You can always drive more value out of it. Rather than going with one SQL system that tries to solve every possible thing, you can actually identify the key use cases that you want and leverage the right set of tools to actually accomplish that. So on that note, I just wanted to quickly summarize, you know, the different options that we talked about. We talked about DynamoDB, which is our NoSQL database. And DynamoDB is pretty much used extensively across ad tech, IoT, gaming, mobile, and web scenarios. I'm pretty sure most of you might have something running in those, you know, scenarios too. You heard from Jiangsang around the ad tech part, where latency is such a key thing, and also scale is needed when you scale to, you know, hundreds and thousands of users, in some case millions of users, in some case millions of devices. Now, all those situations are where DynamoDB can help you a lot. It's going to provide you a consistent level of latency. It automatically replicates your data across three different availability zones. It also is super easy to use. You don't have to bother about nodes. You can just turn on the knobs and you can get going. The other big solution, of course, is RDS, which provides you a managed solution for various SQL engines. We saw that, you know, all the popular SQL engines, whether it's MySQL or whether it's PostgreSQL or SQL Server or Oracle, is supported by RDS. Worthwhile noting is also Aurora, which offers you much higher performance, pretty much 5x higher performance in MySQL. And it's fully compatible with MySQL. And so if you're looking at a MySQL solution, you might want to evaluate Aurora as an option. Again, with RDS, you have all the key functionalities like encryption at rest, VPC, cross-region replication, automatic backup, multi-AZ deployments, and automatic failover from one to the other. So you have all those facilities already available for you, preset. You can just configure it by a click of a button and get going. You don't have to bother about your hardware. You don't have to bother about the database management part. Everything is taken care of. The other thing is, of course, Elastic Cache, which is our in-memory key value store. So with Elastic Cache, definitely, you know, it can help you reduce the latencies for your application by actually adding a caching layer or an in-memory store for key data types and key scenarios. Again, Elastic Cache supports Memcached and Redis, two of the key caching engines, and worthwhile, you know, considering which ones you want. Memcache is very simple key value pair, while Redis provides you much more complex data types, in-memory lists and sets, et cetera. So worthwhile identifying which ones of these two that you would like for your business. The last one that we looked at is, of course, Redshift. It is super fast, much, much more simpler, and much, much more cheaper than most of the other options that you can find in the market. It's a, you know, SQL-based, you know, data warehousing solution, scales up to petabytes, and you can get started with as less as 25 cents an hour. And for, you know, you can get 1 terabyte a year for pretty much less than $1,000. So in terms of key advantages, just to, you know, summarize, with managed databases, yes, you don't have to, you know, run around hardware and other things, so it's easy for you. Scaling is much, much more easier. In many cases, you have, you know, you just have to click a button, or you can have to just change an instance, and it scales and adjusts automatically for you. You can always pull it up or pull it down. You have the facility of elasticity, so you can adjust it based on your business requirements, and you can also, you know, your cost is dependent on what you use, and so you don't end up paying too much. And so that's the other big advantage in terms of price benefits that you have compared to the folks that you need to manage and maintain your systems. As Jiangsang mentioned, they've even changed their recruitment policy now. They're no longer looking at folks who are actually trying to maintain or, you know, manage infrastructure, and rather they're focusing a lot more on developers who can actually build the application, right? That way, they are also optimizing towards what they think is the most ideal thing in terms of differentiator for their customers and their business. And finally, with all these options, you definitely have the benefit of the huge AWS ecosystem. You have, you know, interoperability, whether it's S3 or EC2 or data pipeline. You know, all these services, because they're part of the AWS ecosystem, they easily interoperate and they can be, you know, used together. So in the end, you know, I'm sure some of you might be interested in specific technologies. Some of you would want to dive deeper, may have some more questions on these. I definitely would encourage you all to go into some of these deep dive sessions. This is just a couple of those that I've listed here. There are a lot many that you can look at. Even if you could not attend some of these, you can look at the video on YouTube. So some key things, definitely, you know, there's a session on Redshift, there's a session on NoSQL services, there's a deep dive on Aurora, specifically, if you're interested in that. There's also a session on Elastic Cache. There's a workshop for DynamoDB. You know, there's even things around event-driven programming and things like that, if you're interested. Worthwhile, you know, checking it out. So with that, you know, I'd like to conclude. Hopefully this session was beneficial to all of you. Hopefully it's given you enough insights to bring down your worries and, you know, push more value, drive more value for your business and your customers. Thank you, everybody.